All right, so last time we left off, we were talking about Manifest Destiny and how the United States is expanding out west. After the Civil War, the Eastern Coast is going through Reconstruction, and the South is going through that especially. So we are looking out to the west to expand our dominance and our imperialistic goals of becoming a stronger, more dominant nation by extracting resources out into the west. And with that, we are going to run into some problems and run into some hostility. And that's where we're going to start today. Stay tuned. It's going to be a good one. You got that right. We're getting into Custer's Last Stand. And what a guy. Let me tell you. Bye-bye, General Custer. I'll tell you what, kids. We're at a hot interview right now with General Custer. Yep, you got that right. Custer from Custer's Last Stand. But before we get to that, I want to get into his background. Okay. So, General Custer, thanks for being on the show. I really appreciate it.
Hey, Mr. Roman, thanks for having me on.
Awesome. Love having an Ohio guy on the show. This is nice. This is nice. Hey, just tell us a little bit about your background. What's going on here?
Yeah, I'll give you a little bit of my background. Obviously, I was raised in Ohio and born in Ohio, and I went to primary school in Ohio. I graduated from McNeely Normal School. I would not say that I was the best of students. I always seemed to find myself in trouble in school, and ended up moving up to Michigan with my sister and my brother-in-law. And after spending some time up there, I actually taught school for a little bit, just like you. I got my teaching degree, certificate, whatever you want to call it, and was gonna teach grammar school. Obviously, that didn't work out, and I matriculated my way down to the U.S. Military Academy to try to make myself something out of myself. Ended up graduating in 1861 from the U.S. Military Academy, and similar to my exploits in grammar school, I found myself in trouble there quite often. I was known as kind of the class jokester, and would prank my fellow comrades there at the military academy, and often was punished for that, and ended up graduating last in my class at the military academy. And shortly after graduating, obviously the Civil War had broken out by that point, and I found myself on the front lines, and made a name for myself rather quickly there, and caught the eye of some of the major generals for the Union Army, and got myself Cavalry Commission.
Awesome. Hey, you know what they say, D's get degrees, right? No, I'm just
That
kidding,
is
kids.
correct.
I'm kidding, kids, but hey, that's what we need. I mean, hey, if you get past it, yeah, whatever. I mean, let's just forgive and forget that. Custer, it's great to have you on the show here, especially with your time during the Civil War. Just give us a little bit of content about that. And we talked a little bit about the Civil War. We talked a little bit about Gettysburg. What do you have going on about Gettysburg? What was your time there at that significant battle, the turning point?
Well, before the Battle of Gettysburg, like I said, I was commissioned in 61 Cavalry. I worked my way up through, and I made a name for myself by my heroic actions on the battlefield. Obviously, I was one of the first ones in there. When the battle would break out, I'd lead my soldiers in myself, and kind of made a name for myself for my ability to be a tactician on the battlefield itself. And before you know it, at the young age of 23, I became a brigadier general of the U.S. Volunteers leading the Michigan Cavalry Brigade. I was dubbed the boy general, but I could handle my own. Obviously, I was involved at the Battle of Gettysburg there, where I was able to fend off Jeb Stuart, who was obviously the famed Confederate general, the eyes of Robert E. Lee, who showed up late at the Battle of Gettysburg. I was able to fend off his attack on the third day of the battle and kind of save the day for the Union cause at the Battle of Gettysburg, once again proving my worth as a commanding general. And obviously, throughout the rest of the war, I continued to prove my worth as a general. During that period, I kind of made a name for myself as kind of this invincible cavalry general, as I had 11 horses shot out from under me. I may add. Yeah, 11 horses shot out from under me, and kind of developed this invincibility about myself that nothing could happen to me.
Well, I'll say, I mean, hey, 23 years old, you're out there really having leadership over the battlegrounds in Gettysburg, one of the most significant battles ever in American history. And there you are, controlling most of the Union Army and stopping Jeb Stuart himself. And let's face it.
If I may add something too, Mr. Bowman.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was the one that stopped Robert E.'s last retreat into Northern Virginia, and I was the one to receive the flag of surrender from Robert E. Lee, and I was there at Appomattox Courthouse as Robert E. Lee signed the unconditional surrender that was put in front of him by General Grant.
Well, let's face it. I mean, Ulysses S. Grant had a lot of confidence in you, and he thought of you as a high standard, especially being a young age. And I get why you have that, you know, that ability and that thought of being invincible. Well, who won, right? Who won?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Awesome. Hey, that's some good stuff there, Custer. And that's going to lead us right into what we're talking about today. And why do you think, I mean, obviously with your standing, your background of being this very high acknowledged and superior general during the Civil War itself, but you know, what made the United States think that you were the right choice leading Manifest Destiny and expansion out in the West against who knows what's out there? Who knows exactly what's going to stop us or who's going to come into confrontation with the United States as we're expanding out to settle this frontier?
Well, after the Civil War was over and surrender took place, and the Reconstruction started. I was recommissioned out to the Kansas underneath William Hancock, General William Hancock, and I was recommissioned out there to obviously deal with the Native Americans out there and our expansion westward and to help our colonists settle and to obviously expand our country westward. And I think they had great faith in me because of my willingness to put everything on the line, specifically in battle, and to do whatever was necessary to get the job done, whatever the order may be. I think my record itself during the Civil War was enough in itself for them to put their faith in me.
Awesome. Yeah, I believe it. Who wouldn't? And especially the success he had there in the Civil War with, you know, the turning point in the Civil War, everything, the Union finally taking a stand there and turning the tides of the war. And then obviously, I mean, let's face it, the expansion out in the West, Manifest Destiny, is trying to persuade people to move out into the West, to persuade people to move out in the frontier. And I'm thinking gold had to really push people out there as well, right? I think you especially were the one who was trying to say, you know what, in the Dakotas, in Dakota Mountains, in the Black Hills, there is a huge, large amount of gold, and that's what's pushing us up here, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, I was involved in that, and I want to kind of clear the air a little bit here in terms of the perception of myself. I was kind of looked at and had a perception of someone that was always in the pursuit of glory and fame, and my actions at points kind of alluded to that a little bit. Sometimes I was a little careless in my efforts, and one time I even abandoned my post to visit my wife, which I was court-martialed for, but anybody would do that if they missed their wife, right?
Oh, who would? Who would?
Yeah. I think it was very, very important for us to expand up into the Black Hills territory there, and not necessarily that it was our right, but the resources that were there obviously would benefit our country greatly. The Native Americans obviously did not want to give that territory up, and we had a fight for that territory. And we ended up pushing those Native Americans out, which were the Sioux. And those Sioux would end up joining forces with the Native Americans in the Little Bighorn Valley further south.
I got you. So the Sioux Wars, I mean, they've been established there. They've been happening for many, many years. And your presence there in North Dakota is in the Northern Territory there, closer to Montana. Let's face it. I mean, you're all about the gram, right? You're all about the image. You're always about looking the best, the precise image for the American people. You're always having the slick back hair in your photos, a nice mustache. You're looking good for the ladies, right?
Yeah, you got to make yourself look good. You know, my wife, she was a really big part of my life, and she wanted me to look good, and I wanted to look good for her. That was Elizabeth Bacon Custer, and I wanted to make sure my long golden locks were looking as good as possible in every single picture that was taken, and they smelled good too. You know, I oiled those locks up quite often.
Hey, I believe it. I mean, bacon, custard, I mean, that sounds really good. If that was wrapped up in a pie or a cake or something, I would definitely eat that up. So, yeah, I totally agree with what you're saying here. Who wouldn't try to look good with what they're trying to accomplish? All right, so the Sioux Wars. What exactly did you think you're gonna get yourself into, especially out in the Black Hills, out in this uncharted territory, out in the frontier? I mean, it's just something that's unpredictable, and for a general like yourself, it's just something that you want to strategize towards. What did you expect out in this territory, out in this land?
Well, to be honest with you, Mr. Bowman, kind of underestimated, and I think a lot of people underestimated the willpower and the fighting spirit of the Native Americans on the plains, specifically in the Black Hills. Wasn't like the fighting that took place in the Civil War. It wasn't like fighting Johnny Reb on the Civil War battlefields. These people were fighting to preserve a way of life and to preserve their land in which they believed they had a claim to. So they were willing to fight to the death, to the end, where some of the soldiers that served underneath me and soldiers that fought during the Civil War weren't necessarily fighting for a cause or fighting to preserve their way of life, but fighting for that paycheck. So it was a little bit different. So when we went out there to fight the natives, we underestimated them a little bit. Like I said, I'm always up for a challenge, and I proved myself during battles during the Civil War, and I knew, or I believed, that I would be able to succeed in any endeavor that I put my mind to. So in the case of the Black Hills, I believe we'd be able to drive the natives out of the Black Hills and claim that for ourselves and continue to expand westward.
Awesome. So this threat that you were approached with, you thought that, you know what, we're just going to mow through them, that we have the confidence, we have the ability to do this, we have the advanced technology and weaponry to expand out into the West to claim this land, but you really didn't understand the willpower of these warriors out in the West that the Native Americans had, that they acquired, right? The willpower of these men.
Absolutely. The willpower and, you know, and a lot of it has to do with their culture and their beliefs and what they were fighting for. They're fighting to protect not only their land, their ancestors and their ancestors before them had laid claim to and had lived upon, but also their families too, their livelihood. So they were really willing to fight to the bitter end.
Awesome. So at the time, I'm sure you didn't really have much respect for these Native Americans. But now, RIP, after your death, and after these events that happened here, you have a more respect, you have a more disciplined approach towards this group than you did when you actually fought them, correct?
Absolutely. And you have to remember too, you know, I was invincible. That was my thought process. I was trying to make a name for myself. And by claiming the Black Hills, that's obviously making a name for myself. That's expanding westward, right? That's a lot of resources for the United States of America. Obviously, that ushered in a gold rush into that area, and we expanded westward. We had a lot of people that flocked to that area trying to seek a new life, to gain riches. And it was our job to protect those people from any native incursions.
Awesome, awesome. I mean, you said it best there. I mean, with your time at Gettysburg, you were trying to fight off the rebels. And at that point, you thought you were invincible. It's like, you know what? I went toe-to-toe with those men that were superior to me at West Point. Obviously, you stated that within your rank and within your graduate status at West Point. And you thought, well, this is going to be a walk in the park, that this is going to be a breeze for us United States soldiers and our strategies going out into the West, that we can claim this land, no problem. It's going to be a breeze. It's going to be a walk in the park. But later you figured out, you know what, it's a lot tougher than I thought. A lot of these Native American groups are binding together and, you know, forming this confederacy to fight against the United States advancement in the West, to a point where it's even challenging for you and the U.S. soldiers, right?
Absolutely. And like you said, once we had kind of pushed the Indians out of the natives out of the Black Hills region there, they had moved south and joined forces with Sitting Bull and Crazy Horse and other leading Indian chiefs, creating this, like you said, large confederation tribes that massed about, you know, 7,000 plus individuals, which is a significant force to be reckoned with.
Oh, for sure, for sure. And especially the force that you had out in the West. It's like, it's land that you never seen before, that you never encountered. So a new environment and a new type of fighting style that you never really encountered. And obviously, it's going to be a little bit challenging for you, but you had no idea what you're going to step, you know, you're going to get yourself into, correct?
Yeah, it was completely different. You know, we had the Napoleonic tactics during the Civil War, where essentially, you know, we're in columns, we're lined up, we're facing one another, we're fighting one another. And then we go out west to fight the Native Americans, and they're more guerrilla in their warfare. They know the lay of the land. They know how to operate. They know where the advantages are. We're essentially blind, and trying to figure things out on the fly, where they obviously have those advantages over us.
Yeah, and especially your confidence too at that point. You're trying to make a name for yourself. You're trying to really standpoint and you're trying to like really stamp yourself into the United States history books as one of the most greatest generals of all time. So you're leading the charge. You're out in front of your men, which many generals really don't do. But, you know, a lot of people have to admire yourself of leadership. And it's like, you know what? I'm leading myself. I'm leading my troops into battle. I'm going at it. Full head of steam. Whatever happens, happens, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that kind of came full force at the Battle of Little Bighorn. We had orders to scout out the Indian encampment. Obviously, we had done that. We knew their forces were large, that we were outnumbered. I was ordered to wait for reinforcements, but, you know, like I said, I was very confident in my abilities, so I decided to go ahead and not wait for those reinforcements and circle the native encampment in the Valley of Little Bighorn there, because obviously our scouts had reported to us that they were there. Instead of, once we encircled them, instead of waiting for those reinforcements, I decided to initiate an attack.
I got you. So looking back at the battle, and obviously it's a little bit different than from what you know of it. Would you try to alter your strategy, your movements onto the battlefield, knowing what might have happened?
Well, hindsight, I definitely would change my strategy. But at that time, I was extremely confident in my abilities, even though we were greatly outnumbered. I had split our forces into three different groups. And like I said, we were greatly outnumbered. They were 7,000 plus, probably about 2,000 plus warriors, and we had about 600 men. Not only that, but they had an advantage. And it's hard to say this, but they had a technological advantage because they had repeating rifles, and our cavalry generals only had long rifles. So obviously, their firepower was much greater than ours.
So how did that happen? How did that happen? How did that happen, man?
Well, the natives were very resourceful in getting the resources out there, and the repeating rifle became a part of their repertoire, I guess you can say, the Henry repeating rifle. And we were kind of lagging behind in terms of the technology we had, and maybe it's because of the Civil War and Reconstruction and our economy and stuff like that. What eventually happened there at the battle itself, like I said, I decided not to wait for reinforcements because I was confident in my abilities. I believed we'd be able to go down there and beat them, and I was counting on my co-generals and or my co-officers in the battle, Reno and Benteen, to reinforce me. However, that did not happen. Reno and Benteen had charged on the southern end of the battlefield, and once they realized that they were greatly outnumbered and the Indians had the repeating rifles and they only had their long rifles, they had quickly retreated to higher ground. And on the northern end of the battlefield, I decided to attack myself, and I'm not one to retreat.
No.
We went in there, and I was expecting them to be fighting on the other end, and they weren't. They retreated, so now I had the full force against myself, and we were obviously massacred. There was only one survivor, and that was the messenger I sent to both Reno and Benteen to send reinforcements into the battle to help us, and both of those men refused to send reinforcements into the battle to save us. Maybe that's because of the relationship they had with me. They didn't really like me, but obviously, in hindsight, I would probably do things differently.
I got you. So, I just see your motto being, you know what? We're either going to go big or we're going to go home, right?
Exactly.
Go big or go home. Custer doesn't mess around, right? Big Dog Gator doesn't mess around. So he's going for gold. He ain't stopping for less. He's not going to stop for anything that's less than achievement. And, hey, you got to respect the man for that, right?
Exactly. You know, come home with your shield or come home on it, right?
Hell yes. That's what I like to hear. That's what I like to hear. Hey, Custer, I appreciate being on the show today. Talking about the Battle of Little Bighorn. You know, that's some great stuff there. That's some history that we really don't talk about too much, and understand how that's a part of Manifest Destiny and how that's a part of American imperialism expanding out into the West and becoming a stronger, more dominant country eventually in the world. I mean, let's face it, in a couple years, several decades, we'll become one of the most dominant industrial economies in the world. And that's because of our use with the resources that we have granted ourselves, that we have accomplished, that we have conquered out into the West. And hey, and although it was somewhat of a failure, let's face it, your story, your ballad really hits home of what we're talking about with Manifest Destiny and United States imperialism.
Absolutely. You want to gain anything in life, there's always a cost associated with those gains.
Of course. And let's face it, your goal was, hey, go for gold. And let's face it, that's what you're doing.
Absolutely.
Especially like those little locks you got, those golden locks, that golden little mustache. I mean, who wouldn't go for golden with that facial expression, right?
Absolutely.
I'm sure the missus loved that.
She did.
God bless her soul. God bless her soul. Hey, thanks a lot for being on the show. Is there anything you can offer for the UDA students right now?
Hey, yeah, just stay safe. Go for the gold. Always strive for excellence, no matter what anyone says. Got a task ahead of you or a task to accomplish, and set your mind to it and do whatever's necessary to get it done. That's kind of what I base my life off of, the motto I live my life of, and that's what everybody should base their life off of also.
Awesome, awesome. Hey, it's okay to be overconfident in some cases, especially when you're trying to go for gold, especially when you're trying to accomplish goals that your country, that you are trying to establish yourself as a human being. And that's what Custer did. That's what Custer did. And we can respect that as American citizens. And hey, I appreciate you being on the show. Thanks again. Give my condolences to the missus. And hey, we'll see you next time. Maybe we'll get you on the show again sometime, Custer.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Bowman. Thank you for having me on. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Hey, there you have it. General Custer there. We're talking about American imperialism and how the United States is expanding out into the frontier and becoming a more dominant power, not only in the United States and the Western Hemisphere, but the world. All right, we're extracting resources from this Western frontier, and we're applying it to our industrial centers on the Eastern Coast. And General Custer, although he had this last stand, although he had this problems, this conflict in the North Dakota region, he really pushed the United States to become this dominant power. He helped us become this stronger, more industrial, more innovative country, especially extracting these resources and expanding it to our industrial centers. And he allowed us to become this more superior power in the world. So with Custer's last stand, yeah, with the Sioux War and everything, it might have been a drawback and might have been a failure for him, but hey, it was a big success for the United States and becoming a superior power. Hey guys, hope you enjoyed it. Hope you had a great time today. We'll see you next time.